about automating type design processes. And I want to start with a quote by Donald Knuth. Instead of imagining that our main task is to instruct the computer what to do, let us concentrate rather on explaining to human beings what we want the computer to do. And today you heard a lot about Icarus, and you also know that there's a lot of Icarus technology in the software we produce in FontMaster. And we have several modules actually, and the most important modules are the editors of the Bezier format and Icarus formats. And this is part of a structure I made a long time ago where I put all the parts of the production, font production process and type design process in parts, and for every part we produced actually a model, a module. And this is nice when you produce fonts because you have a specific module for this task and not a heavy program with all kind of functionality that you don't need at the moment. Actually, it's also nice for us for producing it, because if we want to improve it or remove a bug, we only have to focus on that specific module. What's missing here actually is a module for type design. So we have a lot of batching power in the program, but actually on top you would actually want to start with a program that does at least a part of the tedious work for you. And type designing is tedious work. It's as some of you know who design typefaces themselves. So it would be nice if there was a program that would do some of the work for you, but then you have to actually define the structure that is underneath. And I'm talking about Latin at the moment. So I'm actually doing a PhD research at Leiden University, and there are two main parts actually. I'm trying to describe harmonic systems and models on macro level, and on micro level, detail descriptions of these letter models. Here at the bottom right, you can see the letter modeler and letter measurer, which are software modules. And actually, the letter modeler is on your CD, and I will show you a little bit later on. What always intrigued me is that, for instance, in music, there is a treatise on harmony by Jean-Philippe Rameau. It's 18th century. And there are quite some books that describe the harmony in Western music, but it isn't actually a description of the harmony of the Latin script itself. So I thought by myself, there should be a description, and actually there should be a definition of all the systems and models that you can find in the Latin script. This is the traditional way we look at the Latin script. We use variants, capitals, Roman, cursives, and Gerrit Noorzee, for instance, calls these form sorts or construction sorts. And actually this indicates that it's a coherent system, that everything that's in the capitals works well together, and all the letters that are in the Romans work well together, and the same with cursive. And I never liked that idea, actually. I always thought there is more, and every system, because I would like to call it a system, contains several models that are combined. I must underline that this is also a question that came up in time, because I'm a lecturer in The Hague at Royal Academy, and at some point I was thinking to myself, I'm conditioning the students based on the convention, and by doing this I'm actually preserving the conventions by this conditioning. So it's actually something that supports both sides and doesn't actually I raised the question by myself, is this correct? So I came up with systems and models, and what I'm trying to say is that capitals are an harmonic system, and romans are an harmonic system, and cursives are an harmonic system. And every system is not a coherent system by definition, but contains other systems and other models. So where to place it in total, this is a little bit simplifying the matter, but on top you have scripts, then you have writing systems, and writing systems contain alphabets and derived characters and non-letter characters. And some of these can be shared between the writing systems. And there you can see where I placed then the harmonic systems and the other models. And I will give a brief description of these systems and models. First of all, I think you have to understand, as my opinion, that the letters we are using got their shape in the 15th century and actually were fixated by the invention of the art of book printing. So when this invention would have been made, for instance, earlier in the 11th century or even early in the 9th century, probably we were using different letters today. So designers are making variants on a theme that got its shape in the 15th century. If you realize this, then you should actually go back to the basis and try to explain what's underneath. And then perhaps it's also, and I will come to this later on, easier to explain, or try to explain, or even try to measure legibility. So let's have a brief look at harmonic models. So if you look at these letters, they all share the same construction, and there's only a difference in weight, and this difference is caused in both cases in the top row and the bottom row by different effects. In the bottom row, the broad nib has the same width everywhere. In the top row, for the bold version, a bolder nib was used. So I made a simple structure actually, and some simple math were involved, and I came to this model. And here I had a Johnson moment, because Edward Johnson in the 1920s came up with a construction which basically looks like what I've put in the geometrical model. He really understood how the relation between the strokes and the letters worked. If you come up with a model for Roman and text letters, you can come up with a derived model for cursives. So we have models for the construction of the letters, and related to this, in my opinion, you have a proportional model. So if you look at a typeface, you can play with the basic elements. You can stretch them, but as you can see, when you stretch and condense the shapes here, the stem width remains the same. So it's not condensing and expanding what you can do, for instance, with letters on your computer. And if you say there is a basic system underneath with fixed proportions, then you can measure variance on this system. So this is Van der Keren, which is a French Renaissance typeface made in Antwerp by Hendrik Van der Keren for Plantin around 1570. And this is the Parangon Romain originally, and I'm pretty sure it's completely based on the Paragon Romain by Garamond. As you can see, I used the model underneath and actually didn't change any of the proportional systems, and it fits. So the N fits, the B fits, the C fits, which means that the round letters and the stem letters fits in the model as it is. If you notice, you can use it to measure typefaces. You can see where it derives from the original models. And again, I'm saying the original models are in the Italian Renaissance and then were used by French pansculpteurs like Garamond. And here I used it to measure the proportions of types. you could make a program, a letter measure. Actually, I'm working on this, where you use the models to measure a typeface and to try to find and to explain actually the differences between the typefaces by measuring it against models. And these models, you can use the original models, but also the proportional variants. And this gives you much more information than this. This is actually the classical way we look at typefaces, and the only thing you can conclude here, yeah, they are different. Also, the colors are different. But it doesn't say you anything about the design, and doesn't say you anything about the construction and the proportions. When there is a system for the construction and the proportions, there must be a system where you, for instance, can explain the contrast, and I call this the relational system, and I'm not only trying to explain the contrast, but also the this is also the contrast. Also here, only here it's different than the first. Here it's the broad nib against the X height, and here actually the thickness of the pen has changed. So here you get a lower contrast. And at the end is the rhythmic system. So if you say it's a system and I can explain the construction of the letters and their shapes, I can also explain the spacing of the letters and the position of the letters in a word. This is a little bit different than the approach that, for instance, you say the space by definition that's in the character should be placed between the characters. You could reverse this. You could say, no, if that's the case, when you design a typeface, you should design it in such a way that you always have this situation. In other words, for instance, you could say that serifs are elements that are added to a typeface. You could also state that serifs preserve the rhythm, so you should make the serifs in such a way that you, by definition, get the rhythm that is defined in the letters themselves. It's a little bit more complex, but it means for me that it's not arbitrary, which is actually the most difficult point. People look at typefaces and say, oh, I like this typeface. Why? Oh, the contrast, the shape. But what exactly are you looking at? And it's even more complex when it comes to legibility, because you can say this is not legible, and then the question is, why not? And then you can say, yeah, it's not what I expected, or the spacing is uneven. But the problem with legibility research, for instance, is that when you give people a text typeset in different typefaces, and it's the same text, the second time they read the text, the typeface reads better because already they know the text. So by definition, it's easier to read the text. It doesn't say anything about the typeface. Actually, my statement is that if you have the models and the structure, and you realize that everything is related to each other, you should do legibility research by the computer, by software, and not by humans anymore. Which is a little bit controversial, I must say. So here I used the system underneath to find the position of the letters. And here I did the same. So here the spacing is directly defined by the system itself. So it's not optical space here. Nothing optically has been done. If you can define basic shapes, then some of the stuff, of the design stuff, could be done by software. And there is software on the CD, and I will start it to give you an impression. So you can play around a little bit. You can start becoming a type designer without having any knowledge, which is also nice. So here I'm just changing parameters, and immediately the letters change. I can change the pen angle, and of course it doesn't work everywhere. So here with the H and the N, you get problems, and then you can define exceptions. for the width, for the pen angles, etc. Which, that's something that when you write with a broad nib, you will do automatically. It's quite easy to change your parameters when you are writing. It is more difficult to define actually what you are doing. And my students in The Hague now are using this on their tables when they are writing with a broad nib. So that's an interesting view, writing with a laptop in front of them. Of course, you can play with the ascenders and the descenders. And there are some predefined sets. And you could, for instance, add serifs. If you say serifs are a part of the same system, when I change something somewhere, the serifs will change too. This is something we have to work on because it only works here for the diagonals. But also is interesting, you can see what happens actually when you dive in the medieval period. So I will keep this to one. We'll remove the serifs here. Then you also explains that the Renaissance and all the models before are directly connected. You can define them actually in the same model. So if you like, you can play with the software, and actually you can generate a font and open it in some of the FontMaster modules, and it's the first font in some of the cases that you have made it. It's a start. A lot of work has been done already by UOW on programming this. It's a start, and but you need the basic construction to go further. I will skip this part for a moment. This is more interesting. To go further and at the end to define actually also what you think is beautiful. I had a discussion with David Lemon of Adobe, and he said at some point, I don't like it that a computer will do the designing for me. And I said, why not? It's difficult, but I want to make things that are beautiful. And I wrote to him actually, can you define what you think that is beautiful? And at the end, when you can define it and write it down, we should be able to program it also. And otherwise, it's something that's in the air, which I think a lot of designers are doing is sometimes in the air, but I really want to get grip on it and want to know how it works and what it is. When you look at the model, you could say, okay, but this is simplifying the stuff. You're putting it in one model and that's it, and it's much more complicated. Another approach could be that you start with a skeleton line on which you apply the effect of a broad nib, and there is software where this happens. Actually, in many books you will read that what happens when you write with a broad nib, and actually the shapes of the letters of the broad nibs are the result of writing a certain shape on which the effect of the broad nib is applied. And I think this is completely incorrect. And I made here more or less an arbitrary skeleton line, as you can see on the left, and then I applied broad nib with an angle of 15 degrees and 30 degrees on it, and in both cases the result is not perfect, but with 30 degrees it's much more in the direction that you expect. So the connection of the arch and the stem is much more what we are used to see. In other words, you can't make an arbitrary, or it's not completely arbitrary of course the end, but you can't make a skeleton line and then apply the effect of broad nib on it. So let's have a look. So this is the effect with 30 degrees on the left and then 50 degrees on the right. And when you look at the skeleton lines, they differ completely. And actually this explains what happened in history. The letters we are using now are based on models that were written with a broad nib and completely find their construction in the broad nib. It's not something that has been applied because they were not writing these letters with a marker and then adding the effect of the duplicate tip to these shapes. This is the vector bridge. And to simplify this explanation, the vector bridge should be in the direction of the broad nib angle. So you should have a line there that's in the direction of the angle you are using. You will find also the VWXYZ in the software, and especially when you apply some extreme parameters, you will see some silly things. And then you could say, oh, the model doesn't work. But actually, the model works, and it underlines what I said earlier. It isn't a coherent system that we're using. It's a collection of shapes, and we like to see it as a coherent system, but actually it isn't. It is good, it works for us, but it's far from perfect, the Latin alphabet. So perhaps it should have a different approach. And when you look at history, you can see that the K and the V and the W, X and the Y and the Z and also the S are derived from the, or actually taken from the capitals, and the capitals originally, the Roman capitals, they found their origin in the Greek capitals, and the Greek capitals were actually written in skeleton lines. So what doesn't work for most of the letters in the model I just showed works actually for the capitals, because the Romans vectorized the system of the Greeks. And the simple geometric shapes the Greeks were using, then it's no problem to apply the broad nib. So you can apply a broad nib to these shapes. And what we're now working on is for instance, the capitals, there will be skeleton line shapes in the Latin modeler on which you can apply the same effects that you selected for the harmonic model of the text letter. So if you change some of the parameters, it will be applied to the capitals and probably without any problems. And these shapes, you can modify as much as you like until they fit the Roman letters. So it's just a collection, a library of skeleton lines. And then of course, when it works for the capitals, it also works for the letters which are taken from the capitals, which are the K, the X, the V, the W, X, Y, Z, and in my opinion also the S. But I'm not sure about that completely. Of course, when you work on something like this, people say, it's something that, for instance, people like Dürer did in the 16th and 15th century. Also a lot of Italians worked on this, but it's not. This is actually defining the shape from the outside. You have a shape which is fixed, and then you try to explain it with a ruler and a compass. Something about legibility. I said it before, and that legibility is a complex thing, and this is what Gerard Unger writes in his book on reading. The problem with legibility research is that it gives you no clues as a designer to improve the letter forms. Thus, the only thing that you can simply do is to experiment with the shapes. It's not a nice idea, actually. So you can play with it, you can change it, and then it might be better, but look at this. There are a lot of discussions about what reads better, a sans serif or a serif type. And the most used explanation is that the top letters read better because of the serifs. Yeah, why? Well, it gives you a better baseline and it makes it more compact, so it works better. At the bottom, you get the sans serif variant, and here the spacing is identical, so the space within the letters has been placed between the letters, as you can see here. The only thing is that at the bottom the rhythm is disturbed, So when I introduce the stem interval, you can see that the stem interval in the serif letters is almost identical within the M as between the M and the I. And in the sans serif, where you say the space within the letters should be placed between the letters, it's impossible to remain the same spacing. So for me, this is a better explanation why it doesn't work, because the system was invented in the 15th century. It was made with a high contrast, it was made with serifs, and as soon as you make variants on it, at some point you will see that it doesn't work anymore, because or it works, but perhaps less than the original, because you made something that never occurred in the minds of, for instance, Griffo or later Caramon. And when we talk about music, I like to talk about music also, and to combine this a little bit. And for instance, in music you have the cantus firmus. I would say that the serifs are the scriptus firmus, and actually all the information of the typeface is in the serifs. I would go so far as to say that the DNA of a typeface is in the serif. If you have a serif, you can rebuild the typeface. It's like Jurassic Park. We will find a serif of an old typeface and we will rebuild it. And I think you can, basically, because in the serif you'll find the contrast sort, the contrast flow, the weight, and using the same models I showed before, you could use the shape of the serif, the weight, the contrast, to rebuild more or less the typeface. Another one, counterpoint. I think with the change of the counterpoint in music, you also had a change of counterpoint in letters. It actually disappeared in the same period. Here you can see Bach and David Cope, and in automating actually the design, type design part is not done on a large scale in the type world. In the music world, the automating is more advanced, and one of the projects is the EMI project by David Cope, where he actually developed a system, a computer program, that analyzes existing music and rebuilds new music in the same style. So it analyzes the style and the structure of the original composer and generates new music. And he is referring to a game that was played in the 18th century, the Musikalisches Würfelspiel. You probably all heard of the Musikalisches Würfelspiel. You're playing this daily, probably. There's some information on it in the little booklet I wrote, which is also on your desk. It was a dice game. And actually, it was used with predefined bars, and whatever the combination of the bars was at the end, you got a new composition. And Cope is using this, and actually, Mozart and Haydn were doing it, and people think that Mozart invented actually the system, but that's basically, it's probably not true. He was playing the game also, but it's not his invention. Cope is using this. This is all Musikalisches Würfelspiel. Here, bars are used in whatever sequence, and always the result is a new piece of music. And Cope is referring to this. So he's analyzing music, he makes, constructs new bars, and these bars are placed in a different system, and then you get a new piece of music. And also in the music world, what he is doing is considered to be very controversial, because people don't like it. People don't like the idea that composing or designing type is something that could be done automatically. It's part of the higher parts of the human mind, and we don't like to see or to think that computers could do this work for us. Sometimes I say to my students, it's nice when computers do the tedious work, we have more time to go outside and to drink beer. And in the same time, all the basic stuff can be done by computers. So, and at the end, you can tweak it and change it and tell nobody that the computer did most of the work for you and still ask the same price as you did before and drink more beer, etc. It's a nice idea, you would have to say, okay. Let's keep this short. I have the model here. I changed it with Serge, and here I'm taking the next step. Here I'm polishing the stuff. And also this you could do by computers. This is more or less, these are more or less the proportions which Chanson used in the Eusebius. And you can see that the B and the E are relatively wide. And here the bar of the E becomes horizontal, which was the next step actually in the development of type. And here you can see some condensing. And this is actually what you can see in the work of Griffo, which is at the end of the 15th century. For instance, in the Hypnerotomachia Polyphilia from 1499. So this is the history of the type development in a nutshell, and what happens here is that the belly of the A becomes larger and subsequently also the top part of the E. I think this will take quite some time to get the computer do this for us, but this is possible to add the refinement, to polish the stuff. Basically when you can define it, you can program it. More or less. So here again, the change from Chanson to Griffo, and here you can see the originals. This is Griffo, and when you look at the proportions of the round letters like the B and the Q and the O, you can see that when you go to Griffo, the first step is taken to make these more condensed. And this model was used by Garamond in the 16th century, and the Garamond model is and has been the basis for a lot of typefaces since then. So what you can see here is that there is a change of proportional systems, and here you can also measure this and actually write it down and the outcome and see what the differences are. This also explains actually the rotating of the O, which doesn't have anything to do with a change of nib, but it's just a change of counter. As soon as you condense the O or the B or the P, the counter will, the counter axis actually will become more horizontal. So, a little bit Knut here. Most of you know or are familiar with Metafont. Of course, he made a system where you can parameterize the descriptions also of letters, but again, this is more, in my opinion, what Dürer did. This is describing from the outside. You need to shape a certain design, you describe it mathematically, and then you have the option to change the parameters. So I think this is a complete different approach. Another comparison that was made, unfortunately, I don't have an image of this, is with Font Chameleon. Do you know Font Chameleon? Which was a program more than a decade ago. And you could make a lot of Orions, basically actually by interpolating shapes. It was quite an extensive basis of shapes which you could interpolate. And this has nothing to do with my system because there's no interpolation. It's just based on single descriptions of shapes. Here you can see some other stuff steps in describing and refining shapes, and also explain what happens then when a broad nib shape becomes of the O becomes an O like this. You can do this for all details, and at the end you need descriptions for all details, like serifs, to be able to refine and especially define the details. And this is the most difficult part, and actually every designer should be capable of doing this, because he should be capable of defining his own and describing his own parameters he is using. You can see steps where the angle of the pen has been changed, and here the contrast has changed, and here you go from high contrast to an Egyptian, and at the end the next step would be a sans serif. An Icarus image, because I'm talking about serifs, what is a serif at the end? Is it the triangle that is sticking out, or a shape that's related to a triangle, or does a sans serif also has serifs? And here an interpolation has been made between Argo and DTL Argo and DTL Fleischmann, which resulted in DTL R-Fleisch. I'm the only user, so it's not for sale. But you can ask yourself, if a sans serif doesn't have serifs, then there's nothing to interpolate. And there's definitely something to interpolate here, so actually a sans serif has serifs also. The most difficult part at the end is idiom, to describe idiom. If you listen to music and you say, oh, that's Bach or that's Handel, that's because you recognize the idiom. But probably also because you recognize some of the parts, because he has used Bach, for instance, or Handel, they have used the same parts before in other pieces. So actually, idiom is for a large part repeating yourself. Now you're repeating the same tricks, which is also the case of a type designer. But you recognize Hermann Zapf because he is doing the same sort of, he's handling the details in the same sort of way in his different typefaces, independent of the contrast or contrast sort. If you want a computer to design for you, at the end you would like to do this completely, also including the idiom. So that would mean that you have to describe the idiom of your own work, and you could start, for instance, with describing the idiom of Van Krimpen. So what is he doing? How is he tweaking and changing shapes? So here are three A's, and the red one shows a little bit what Van Krimpen normally does with the belly of the A. He's rotating his pen, making some extra tension in the shape. And you will recognize this in almost all his typefaces. In Sheldon, in Haarlemmer, in Spectrum, even in Romulus you will see some of this effect. That really intrigues me. How can you describe idiom? And how can you define it? So you need, in my opinion, simple basic models, and then on top, at the end, when you have described all the details, you can describe idiom. But that's difficult. And actually, what David Cope is doing with EMI is reusing the idiom. He's reusing parts which are very characteristic for a certain composer. And by reusing this and placing the bars in other sequences, he is making new compositions in the style of these composers. But again, this is I probably think that talking about UOW and myself, we'll work for 20 years just to make the simple refinements, and then it will take even longer to describe idiom. That will be the most difficult part. So hopefully, when I'm here at the conference, the let's say 20th DTL Fondmaster conference in 40 years, something like this, I hope to show you that it works with idiom too. So you get a new version of the letter modeler, and there are even more parameters, and you can say, oh, I want a typeface in the style of Hermann Zapf, or Van Krimpen or Garamond or whatever your heroes are, we will put it in it and you'll get your parameters. I think it's possible. This is not really my department. This is Hangul, and this is Kanji. When I worked together with Chris Brandt on Albertina, we had to develop a Cyrillic and a Greek version too, and then he made drawings in the 1950s and 60s for Albertina with Cyrillic and Greek versions. And his opinion was that when you understand Latin and you understand black and white, you can design letters for any script. No way. You can do this as long as you don't show them to other people, then it's okay. But otherwise it doesn't make sense. And to underline actually that our system works for us and what we call legibility, what is legible for us doesn't mean that it's legible for other scripts or that you can apply the same parameters for these other scripts. Which also underlines that the Latin script we are using is not the ideal system. It's a system. It has been developed in a certain direction. It's fixated in the 15th century by the invention of movable types, the art of book printing. But it's not by definition better or worse than other systems, which also means that what we consider to be legible is mostly the, in my opinion, the effect of and the result of conditioning. You have been learned to read these letters, and if you would have learned Hangul or Kanji or whatever at school, you would consider these letters more legible at least than Latin. So that makes it also more complicated for me as a lecturer. And also, again, when it comes to legibility, you can talk about typefaces and you can say, oh, Times is more legible than Garamond or any other typeface. It's at least more legible than Comic Sans. No doubt about that. But when the typefaces come closer, there are a lot of factors that are important, and I think that in most cases not the typefaces are measured, but the typography. So the typeface can be very good. If the typography is lousy, the legibility will also not be okay. So you're not measuring the typeface, you're measuring the typography, of course, in combination with the typeface at the end. If you extrapolate that thought, you could say that the best typography is described by the typeface itself. So in the shapes of the typeface, the proportional systems, the harmonic system, etc., the typography is described and actually should be done by the computer completely based on the models. So no intervention by human beings needed anymore, because in the system itself it's defined. And otherwise, if you don't agree with me, you say that there are a lot of arbitrary factors in involved. So in 25, 30, 35 years we can stop type designing because it will be done by computers. Books will be made, typography will be done by computers, and we don't have to worry about legibility because legibility will be tested by computers. So we can go outside and have a drink, a beer again, and look at the results. As I said, it's a bit controversial, and what scares most people is that I'm simplifying it. It looks like I'm simplifying it in the models. So you can say, no, what I'm doing is much more complex than what you are saying with the models, and the models are not working because they're not working for all the letters in the alphabet. No, the models explain that it's not a coherent system, and by definition, actually, as every writer with a broad nip knows, you have to tweak the V, W, X, Y, Z to let them work in a proper way with the other letters. And when you're designing a typeface, you also know that when it comes to making these letters fit in the rest of the alphabet is always quite complicated. So they look simple with all the diagonals, but they are always a complicated factor when you are designing. Basically, that concludes my talk about harmonic system. Again, coming back to the point that we want to apply all our rules to other scripts too. In this case, it's completely different. The system is different. All our ideas about rhythm and color cannot be found in this system here. So you should not try to apply our rules. And again, that means that our rules are mostly culturally based. You're quite enthusiastic. I expected tomatoes and I'm ready to dive. Are there any questions? None? So you all agree. That's nice. Yeah. I don't think as such that's a good idea, because so much is written nowadays and not read, because there's too much text anyway, but
it can all be already be read automatically.
That's of course the case, yes.
Everybody can go out and drink beer.
It's difficult to compare, of course. Another question?
Yep. I have a related question. I like your music parallel,
mm-hmm.
and I've read about a software that analyzes hit number one hits,
uh-huh.
and looks at them for the recurring patterns,
uh-huh.
and therefore try to create a prescriptive description of those hits in order to create number one hits. So do you see a parallel there?
in analyzing, yes, because that sounds much like what EMI is doing from David Cope for decades already, analyzing music. And if you can analyze what becomes a success, I think you can. People try to do this anyway by copying things that are successful. Not only with type, but also, of course, in the music industry. But it sounds a lot like what David Cope is doing.
Does it sound appealing, though?
You could raise the question: is it nice, the idea? And basically, I don't care, because I want to know if the outcome is that, for instance, somebody asked me some time ago, does this mean that the type design is not art? And I said, if that is the outcome, I will accept it, because I don't want to fool myself. So I want to know, and I don't want to fool my students. Also, I really want to believe what I'm telling them, and not trying to condition them in a way I was taught a long time ago at the academy. I want to know, and if the outcome is that it's even less interesting than art or craftsmanship, I will do something else. I start a cooking school or something like this. But you should not be afraid of asking this question. Also with idiom. So at some point, idiom becomes repeating the same trick again and again. And then it becomes a trick, it's mannerism, and not a quality of idiom. So that's related. Yeah.
why other typefaces more successful than others?
I think that by definition, when typefaces are based on historical models that were the standards, they have more chance to become successful. So based on the proportions and models of Caro-Monfort, for instance. And then, of course, you have typefaces that are a hit, are more successful for a certain period of time because they relate to the pop culture or whatever. I think when you look at the typefaces that were produced at the end of the 1980s, the quality was very low. I mean, that was one of the reasons for me to start TTL.
Mm.
And the quality was low because there were so many self-proclaimed typographers, because all these people bought a Mac, and first in Holland we had 20 typographers, and even less, and then we had a couple of thousand, and these people were uneducated. And when you produce typefaces which have the same level, and this case it sounds a little bit negative, but the level of your audience, they will recognize this quality. And my idea was always, when you, in time, the quality will raise, and the typographers on the computer will become better, and they want typefaces with a higher quality, because that's the next level. And for DTL, it worked out very well. I don't know if I was completely right, but it worked, the idea.
Mm-hmm.
So it depends also on the market that you want to approach. That's of course a very important factor. And we are, with our typefaces, at the high end of the market. But there's still a market for typefaces that are less sophisticated, because a lot of people don't want the sophistication that we offer, or even don't see it. Or we are too expensive, which could also be a factor. Yeah, okay. Then